Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Rebel Star, Our Quest to Solve the Great Mysteries of the Sun, by Colin Stuart. Narrated by Bruce Mann. Introduction. The sun is many things. Beauty, beacon, battery, belligerent. It sustains us, yet threatens too. That it burns our skin from 150 million kilometers away is a hint at its raw power. It's been worshipped as a god and feared as a demon, drives the weather, and helps paint vivid aurorae across polar skies. Its magnetic mood swings flood the solar system with dangerous radiation. Birds sing to greet its daily arrival, only to flee for the safety of their nests when it departs for the night. Plants spring from the earth and unfurl their flowers in its presence. Its ancient energy is liberated from fossil fuels as banks of solar panels attempt to usurp them by drinking in its light. Yet, for something so familiar to us, and so crucial to almost everything that happens on its third planet, the sun remains a confounding mystery. Our understanding tentatively improved when temples made way for telescopes. The last century has seen particular progress, starting with a solar observatory built in California by an astronomical visionary. The space age brought orbiting telescopes, and since the 1990s, we've dispatched an armada of dedicated solar space probes to surveil and scrutinize our nearest star like never before. Thanks to their work, we've finally confirmed where all the sun's energy comes from and how that light meanders towards the solar surface before making its way to Earth. Modern telescopes have witnessed star formation elsewhere in the universe, showing us how our own star came to be. But we have so much left to learn. We're still largely in the dark when it comes to explaining the dizzying array of solar activity. For a century and a half, we've watched the number of dark spots on the sun rise and fall every 11 years or so, but we still cannot forecast the timing or strength of the next cycle. Most pressing is the need to understand and predict the technology-crippling stellar explosions that could send us back centuries. They have the ferocity to fry satellite circuitry, throw power grids into meltdown, and ground international air travel. The sun even nearly triggered a nuclear skirmish at the height of the Cold War. This threat is so serious that governments around the world now see the sun as a foe equal to earthquakes, hurricanes, and terrorism. The sun could cause $1 trillion worth of damage to our electrical infrastructure, from which it would take months, if not years, to recover. Astronomers are so desperate for answers that we now stand on the verge of another sea change in our understanding. Buoyed by these previous successes, the next generation of solar observatories is currently swinging into action. Giant mirrors are being hauled up the sides of enormous volcanoes to peer more closely at the solar surface. They're powerful enough to spot a human at a distance equal to the Earth's width. New space probes are being lofted into the solar system to swing closer to our star than ever before. In November 2018, the Parker Solar Probe broke the record for proximity to the sun. Eventually, it will inch within 6 million kilometers, far inside the orbit of Mercury, tolerating temperatures soaring above 1,000 degrees Celsius. Solar Orbiter will soon use Venus to gradually shuffle its orbit in order to climb high above the Sun-Earth line to get an unprecedented peak at the solar poles, regions crucial in understanding the sun's cyclical nature. In the decade ahead, these intrepid travelers will send back more data on the sun than we've ever had before. There's now so much of it that even an army of stargazers simply wouldn't have time to trawl through it. Artificial intelligence algorithms are being developed around the world to help us make sense of it all. So now is the perfect time to look simultaneously backwards and forwards, returning to a time when the sun was no more than an orb in the sky, and ahead to how our understanding could be about to seismically shift. Charting our journey from monuments to mega observatories, this book will showcase the stunning reality of life beside a stellar powerhouse, shining a light on its perplexing mysteries and exploring the feats of physics that have seen our knowledge grow. Yet, this is more than just a story about a single star. It is also a very human tale, one of our ingenuity and unquenchable desire to learn more. Legions of astronomers have worked for centuries to further our understanding of the sun, with many overcoming significant personal and professional hurdles to add to what we know, such as the astronomers who escaped wars to witness eclipses, or those who smashed the patriarchy to make huge strides forwards and fled political revolutions to kickstart astronomical ones. After seeing how the sun arrived in this otherwise unremarkable corner of the Milky Way, we'll plunge into the core to learn how our star's energy is made, against all the odds, in a place of unimaginable hellfire. From there, we'll fly ever outwards through the solar atmosphere for a brief stop off at the Earth to see how astronomers are trying to tackle the threat of the space weather the sun unleashes upon us. Then it is on past the remaining planets, seeing how they too survive the solar onslaught until we reach the edge of its influence way out beyond even Pluto, before heading into the wider Milky Way galaxy. Our odyssey will end with an account of how the sun, that great giver of life, will ultimately take it away. But our journey starts by looking back at how our understanding evolved from the superstition of the past to the science of today. 1. From superstition to science. The sun, with all those planets revolving around it and dependent on it, can still ripen a bunch of grapes as if it had nothing else in the universe to do. Galileo Galilei. The two hills overlooking the ancient citadel of Sacsayhuaman on the outskirts of the Peruvian city of Cusco are rammed with locals jostling for a view of the events below. Many arrive in the small hours, eager to secure a prime spot. Tourists often pay for grandstand seating in the heart of the action, with prices starting at $100. The surrounding streets are lined with crowds half a dozen people deep. It's the 24th of June, and everyone has flocked here to celebrate the ancient Inca tradition of Inti Raymi, the festival of the sun. This venerable city, the old capital of the Inca Empire, grinds to a halt on this special day as colorful processions and celebrations replace the normal hubbub of traffic. 500 dancers, actors, and musicians are brought in to entertain the crowds. The organizers claim it's the largest festival in South America after the Rio Carnival. Today's events are a modern, pared-down reincarnation of a celebration that began in 1412 to honor the winter solstice, the shortest day of the year in the Southern Hemisphere. It also marked the start of the Inca New Year. Of all their deities, the sun deity, Inti, was the most sacred to the Inca. The solstice was thought to mark his greatest distance from the earth, and the Inca did all they could to beckon him back again to illuminate and sustain them in the year ahead. The original festival lasted for 9 days, with princes, priests, and generals gathered in all their finery to parade and worship. The mummified remains of Inca ancestors were removed from their resting places inside nearby temples and shrines, wrapped in cloth and lofted through the streets on ornate chairs. Golden cups of chicha, an alcoholic drink often made from fermented maize, were raised in a toast to Inti. Hundreds of llamas were sacrificed in his honor at the Coricancha temple, with the surrounding streets running with rivers of their blood, streets that were deliberately built east to west to align with sunrise on the solstice. The animal's internal organs were then picked over for omens of future events, much like the reading of tea leaves. The ritualistic killing of children was not unheard of. This mirrors a similar Aztec tradition where prisoners of war were slaughtered to ensure the sun retained its power and path across the sky. Today's celebrations are somewhat more modest, with just a single llama offered up to the heavens, but the riot of color remains. The wonderful spectacle of Inti Raymi is just one example of the extent to which we humans have revered the sun throughout our history. In Hinduism, the sun is the deity Surya. She's often depicted riding a chariot pulled by 7 horses, one for each of the colors of the rainbow. The redness of sunrise and sunset is in fact Aruna, Surya's charioteer. In Chinese mythology, the sun is the sole surviving sibling of 10 brothers who once shone together in the sky. This proved too hot for the people of Earth, so the hero Ho Yi shot 9 of them down with a bow and arrow. In England, the well-known Neolithic circle at Stonehenge was constructed around 2500 BCE. Its giant stones are aligned with sunrise on the summer solstice and sunset on the winter solstice. Similar stone circles aligned with the sun can be found in Nabta and Karnak in Egypt. Likewise, the temple of Ramesses II at Abu Simbel was built so that the sun illuminates the face of the pharaoh statue on the 22nd of February and the 22nd of October each year, the dates of his coronation and birthday, respectively. The famous pyramids at Giza are orientated almost perfectly to the points of the compass, with many researchers offering different explanations for how they managed it. Some have suggested the sun's position on the autumn equinox helped the Egyptian engineers with the exact alignment. To the ancient Egyptians, the sun was the falcon-headed god Ra, who travelled across the sky in one of 2 boats from east to west each day. Every night, Ra would plunge into the underworld, where the seditious serpent Apophis would try to halt his progress. The sun would rise the next day only if Ra successfully ran this gauntlet. He always did, of course. Pyramids and serpents appear in other sun folklore around the world, too. Back in the Americas, over 4,000 kilometers northwest of Cusco, the ancient Mayan temples at Chichen Itza draw more than 2.5 million visitors a year to Mexico's Yucatan Peninsula. At the center of this architectural wonderland is the temple of Kukulcan, known as El Castillo, the castle. It's a step pyramid completed between 900 and 1000 CE. Around its 4 sides, it boasts a total of exactly 365 steps, one for each day of the year. On the spring and autumn equinoxes, when day and night are equal in length for everyone on Earth, the angle of the sun ensures that the shadows cast by the steps resemble the snake god Kukulcan descending the side of the pyramid. The spectacle lasts just 45 minutes. Appropriately placed stone carvings of a serpent's head help cement the illusion. It's clear the Mayans were avid sky watchers, with many of the site's other temples dedicated to motions in the heavens. The nearby El Caracol structure, nicknamed the Observatory, was constructed so that the planet Venus appears through an opening every 8 years. Heliocentrism. The arrival of the Catholic Spanish conquistadors to Central and South America in the early 16th century put pay to much of the local sun worship. Inti Raymi was outlawed, with the last original Inca festival taking place in Cusco in 1535. It was revived in only 1944. Just 3 years before its abolition, another revolution was stirring back in the conquistadors' home continent of Europe. Polish mathematician Nicolaus Copernicus had just finished his first draft of a highly controversial book that had taken him 16 years to write. The contents were so inflammatory that he sat on it for years. on the revolutions of the heavenly spheres would not see the light of day until just before Copernicus's death in 1543. Its publication marked the beginning of our transition away from the superstition of the past and towards a modern, scientific view of the sun by suggesting it sits at the center of the solar system. That's not to say humans hadn't started to look at the sun in a critical way much earlier. Chinese astronomers were noting the presence of dark patches on the face of the sun as far back as 800 BCE. They were recording these sunspots regularly by 2,000 years ago, but using them to foretell ominous events. In 807, a Benedictine monk named Adelmus spotted a similar blemish that persisted for more than a week. More sunspots appeared around the time of the death of the Holy Roman Emperor Charlemagne in 814. However, that it was also seen by some as an omen and linked to his demise in some way underscores the fact that we hadn't yet moved away from a superstitious view of our nearest star. On Saturday, the 8th of December, 1128, John of Worcester drew the oldest surviving sketch of a sunspot. These observations were all made with the unaided eye, most likely when the glare of the sun was dimmed by clouds. The moon is also an occasional obscurer of the sun during solar eclipses, and our ancestors wasted no time using them to get a closer look. The Greek philosopher Plutarch detailed one solar eclipse, noting that a kind of light is visible about the rim, which keeps the shadow from being profound and absolute. On the 22nd of December 968, there was a solar eclipse visible from what is now Istanbul in Turkey, and the 18-year-old Leo Diaconus wrote, "It was possible to see the disk of the sun, dull and unlit, and a dim and feeble glow like a narrow band shining in a circle around the edge of the disk." Both men were seeing the sun's outermost layer, the corona, for the first time. Solar eclipses also afforded us our first look at prominences, flame-like eruptions seen on the edge of the sun. The Russian Chronicle of Novgorod describes the eclipse of the 1st of May, 1185. "The sun became similar in appearance to the moon, and from its horns came out somewhat like live embers." Despite these early observations, a persistent picture remained popular, that the sun was in motion around the earth. It was this idea that Copernicus famously railed against, and why he and his growing band of followers, known as Copernicans, often ended up in a significant amount of hot water. He argued the opposite, that the Earth is just another planet orbiting a central sun. This belief is called heliocentrism. Copernicus had no evidence that this was indeed true, but he saw it as a much simpler system than the one that had been in vogue since the days of ancient Greece. The Greek polymath Claudius Ptolemy was a passionate advocate of geocentrism, the Earth at the heart of everything, with the rest of the universe in tow. Ptolemy suggested that our planet is surrounded by a series of concentric spheres, each home to a celestial object rotating around the Earth, except that he encountered a problem with the other planets. Many ancient civilizations, from the Egyptians to the Mayans at Chichen Itza, were keeping track of the planets as they wheeled across the sky. They noticed an oddity in their behavior. Often, a planet would appear to stop in its tracks and begin moving back in the other direction. What could cause one of Ptolemy's celestial spheres to suddenly grind to a halt and do an about-face? To get around this inconvenient truth, he introduced the concept of an epicycle, a small circle nested on the bigger sphere. According to this picture, a planet moves around the small circle while being carried around the Earth by the larger sphere. For half of its journey around the small circle, it would appear to be moving against the direction of the sphere, so that's why we see a planet change direction. It was certainly a solution, but a far from elegant one. Centuries later, Copernicus realized you could do away with the whole messy business by simply having the Earth orbit the Sun. That way, planets appear to change direction simply because we overtake them, or they overtake us, on our respective journeys around the Sun. While Copernicus often gets the lion's share of the credit for this insight, others had mooted similar ideas much earlier. Aristarchus of Samos, an ancient Greek living 5 centuries before Ptolemy, had set out his own heliocentric solar system. These ideas failed to break through, however, because of the accuracy with which Ptolemy's geocentric picture could predict the motion of the planets. It also suited the prevailing, largely Christian doctrine in the West, whose creation stories had Earth manufactured by God as a home for humanity. Muslim astronomers were starting to find fault with geocentrism by the 10th and 11th centuries. The Arab astronomer Ibn al-Haytham wrote, "Ptolemy assumed an arrangement that cannot exist, and the fact that this arrangement produces in his imagination the motions that belong to the planets does not free him from the error." Harsh, but true. A truth that would become all too apparent with the invention of one of the most revolutionary pieces of technology in all of human history, the telescope. Arguably, no other device has so single-handedly changed the way we think about ourselves. No longer would we be betrayed by what our eyes alone can see. Discovering sunspots. The first telescopic observations came thick and fast at the start of the 17th century. In Italy, the astronomer Galileo quickly found moons whizzing around Jupiter and vast mountains on the moon. Venus revealed itself to have phases just like the moon, a fact that put the first nail in the coffin of geocentrism. For the light Venus reflects towards Earth to be waxing and waning, we must both be orbiting a central sun. If, as Ptolemy would have it, Venus lay between us and the Sun, then most sunlight would fall on the back of the planet. We'd never see it fully illuminated. That we do proves that Venus ventures beyond the Sun due to its quicker journey around it. Word of Galileo's work soon reached Germany, where a young Jesuit priest named Christoph Scheiner rushed to acquire himself a telescope. After looking at Jupiter and Venus for himself, Scheiner's attention quickly turned to the Sun, where he observed sunspots by using a telescope to safely project a solar image. Galileo had been doing the same, and soon a fierce row erupted between the pair about who had seen them first. Letters were fired back and forth across country borders as the international row escalated. One of their disagreements was on the nature of the spots themselves. Scheiner, being of a religious persuasion, subscribed to the scripture's view of heavenly bodies as pristine and perfect. So to him, these dark blotches must be shadows cast onto the sun's disk by orbiting objects. Galileo countered that they are part of the sun's surface and appeared to change shape. Scheiner's beliefs also made him a geocentrist, not a Copernican like Galileo. That Galileo would eventually be proved right on both counts is a lesson in learning with your eyes and not seeing what you want to see. Scheiner soon became an advisor to Archduke Leopold V, the younger brother of the Holy Roman Emperor Ferdinand II. Leopold was also corresponding with Galileo, and Scheiner explicitly asked him not to tell the Italian about his own work on sunspots. Eventually, that work turned into a series of 4 books entitled Rosa Ursina Sive Sol, which for centuries remained the preeminent texts on sunspots. The first book is used largely to bash Galileo. By the 4th book, Scheiner was using the passage of sunspots across the solar disk to estimate that the sun rotates approximately once every 27 days, a fact that modern astronomers agree with. Much of Scheiner's books were written during his time in Rome, where he'd been summoned to spend nearly a decade overseeing the construction of a new religious college between 1624 and 1633. The end of his sojourn in the Italian capital coincided with Galileo's standing trial in 1633 for his allegedly heretic views on the Earth orbiting the Sun. Two fierce rivals in the same city, one of them a priest with connections to the church. Did China stick the boot in? History serves only to record that the notes of the trial contain a small memorandum stating that the German had opposed the Copernican viewpoint that Galileo was found guilty of spreading. The Italian would spend the rest of his life under house arrest and was not formally pardoned by the church until 1992, all for standing up for what was becoming increasingly obvious to those willing to back what their eyes were telling them. It wasn't the first time an Italian had endured the wrath of the church for their astronomical assertions. A few decades earlier, the Dominican friar Giordano Bruno had been stripped naked, hung upside down, and burned at the stake in the Campo de' Fiori in Rome. Among his perceived crimes was extending the Copernican viewpoint to suggest that all the stars in the night sky are simply faraway suns, perhaps with their own planets to boot. A refusal to recant this and other heretical beliefs cost him his life. Galileo was lucky to escape a similar fate, which he avoided by means of connections within the church, deft political manoeuvring, and even forging letters to cover his tracks. Galileo and China needn't have bickered. The benefit of hindsight shows us that neither astronomer was the first to see sunspots through a telescope. That honour fell to German father and son duo David and Johannes Fabricius. Johannes had studied in the Netherlands, where the telescope had been invented by a Dutch spectacle maker. He returned home with his own instrument and set about observing the sun with his father. In 1611, Johannes produced a little red 22-page pamphlet with the first published details of sunspots as seen through a telescope. Yet even their family ties could not prevent them from arguing about these blemishes. David wrote in a letter to a colleague that he did not believe the spots were a part of the sun. His son was of the opposite opinion. Both men were ultimately united in untimely deaths. First, Johannes died in 1616, aged just 29. The cause of his premature end is unknown. David died the following year when his head was caved in with a shovel following an argument with a peasant he'd accused of stealing a goose. Meanwhile, in England, mathematician and astronomer Thomas Harriot had also been observing the heavens. In the late 16th century, he'd sailed with famed Elizabethan explorer Sir Walter Raleigh as an advisor on astronomical navigation. It was likely during this time, spent in the loftiest circles of English society, that he came across the first English translation of Copernicus's ideas. During one voyage to North America, he observed a solar eclipse from the deck of his ship, and it ignited a lifelong fascination with the sun. By the time the telescope made it to England in the early 17th century, Harriot used it vociferously. He made over 200 observations of the sun, documenting his findings over 73 pages. According to the dates on those pages, he observed sunspots before China, but just after Galileo. Like Galileo, he believed the spots to be artifacts of the sun itself, and not the shadows of China. He did, however, independently verify China's calculation of a 27-day solar rotation. The fact that Harriot's name is so little known compared to his Italian contemporaries is a testament both to the Englishman's natural shyness and to Galileo's penchant for publicity. How far is the sun? By the end of the 17th century, the Copernican viewpoint had gained enough traction to be the dominant view, at least among most astronomers. Attention then turned to learning more about the object in the middle of the solar system. In 1675, King Charles II funded the construction of a royal observatory on the site of a run-down castle set on a hill in Greenwich just outside London. John Flamsteed was installed as the first astronomer royal and tasked with using the stars to perfect the art of navigation at sea. 3 years prior to his appointment to the prestigious post, Flamsteed had calculated the Earth's distance from the Sun using the planet Mars. In 1672, Mars was at opposition, directly opposite the Sun, with the Earth between the two. Flamsteed measured the position of Mars relative to the stars at sunset one evening, before repeating the exercise just before sunrise. In that time, the Earth had moved ever so slightly around the Sun, meaning that Mars appeared shifted against the starry backdrop. Flamsteed was able to turn this small shift into a distance to Mars. This is because the nearer Mars is, the more it would have jumped across the night sky. Try holding your finger up at arm's length and close one eye. Then change the eye that's open. You'll see your finger jump across whatever is in the background. If you do this again with your finger much closer to your face, it will jump a lot further. Astronomers call this technique for measuring distances parallax. Astronomers in Flamsteed's time already knew that Mars orbits 1.5 times further from the Sun than the Earth, thanks to the work of Johannes Kepler. The German mathematician had worked out that the amount of time it takes a planet to orbit the Sun is linked to its distance from it. Now that he knew the exact distance to Mars, Flamsteed calculated that the Sun is 87 million miles away from the Earth. That compares to a modern value of 93 million miles, exceptionally close for the 17th century. Around the same time, the Italian astronomer Giovanni Cassini was taking similar measurements with an equally accurate result. The mass of the Sun. Flamsteed had been a student at Jesus College, Cambridge in 1674, meaning that he was there at the same time as Isaac Newton. The famous physicist had been appointed as their Lucasian Professor of Mathematics in 1669. Like Flamsteed's later job as Astronomer Royal, Newton's role had been officially sanctioned by King Charles II. 3 years before his influential appointment, when the Great Plague forced Newton into exile from Cambridge, he sought refuge back at his family farm at Woolsthorpe Manor in Lincolnshire. It was there that he started to formulate his famous ideas about gravity. Although the well-known version of the story says the spark of insight came when an apple fell on his head, this appears to be untrue. According to the first biography of Newton, written by William Stukeley, he merely saw the fruit hit the grass and was left unscathed. He did, however, realize that the force pulling the apple to the turf was the same as the one keeping the moon in orbit around the Earth, and in turn the Earth encircling the Sun. In 1687, he gifted the world the Philosophiae Naturalis Principia Mathematica, more often known simply as the Principia. The book contains his famous three laws of motion and his groundbreaking work on gravity. But Newton's description of gravity in the earliest editions of Principia was incomplete, particularly when it came to the motion of the moon. To polish it further, he needed accurate astronomical observations. As a mathematician, he turned to Flamsteed for help, beseeching him to share the astronomical data he'd been carefully amassing at Greenwich. Reluctantly, the Astronomer Royal gave the Cambridge professor data on 50 observations of the moon, on the condition they weren't shared publicly. The two men grew to despise each other and often clashed. Flamsteed ruffled Newton's feathers when he announced that the mathematician was publishing a revision to Principia. Newton incensed Flamsteed by publishing his data without his knowledge or permission. not before he'd gone behind Flamsteed's back to Prince George and asked him to press the astronomer to publish. In a letter to a friend, Flamsteed wrote of an encounter with Newton at the Royal Society. "I complained of my catalogue being printed without my knowledge, and that I was robbed of the fruit of my labours. At this he fired, and called me all the ill names, puppy, etc., that he could think of." Newton was, by all accounts, a horrible man, but ultimately right. He had correctly ascribed to the sun the ultimate power, the ability to pull entire planets around it with its gravity. That realization allowed him to publish the first estimate of the sun's mass in the pages of his Principia. According to his universal law of gravitation, a body's mass can be calculated from the properties of an orbiting object. You only have to know the distance at which it orbits and how long it takes to complete one lap. Using the best values for the Earth available at the time, Newton calculated that the Sun is 28,700 times heavier than our planet, a figure that's out by more than a factor of 10. He was, however, using a faulty value for the Earth-Sun distance. Realizing his mistake, he published a revised figure in later editions of the Principia in the early 18th century, stating the Sun was 169,282 times heavier. Today, thanks to even more accurate measurements of our distance from the Sun, astronomers know the Sun's mass is almost twice that. Our star weighs a whopping 2 million trillion trillion kilograms, or 332,946 Earths. As the 17th century rolled into the 18th, we humans had, at long last, put the sun in its rightful place at the heart of our solar system. In fact, the first documented use of the phrase solar system dates to 1704. The solar system is an intricate array of objects all bending to the gravitational will of a massive central sun. We had rough estimates of its size, mass, and distance to boot. Finally, the long journey from superstition to science was complete. Not that it meant all scientific proposals put forward on the sun around this time have aged well. The German-British astronomer William Herschel discovered a seventh planet orbiting the Sun, Uranus, on the 13th of March 1781. It brought him immediate fame and renown, but that didn't stop him proposing some other ideas that today seem more than a little wild. Writing of the Sun in 1795, he noted, "Its similarity to the other globes of the solar system with regard to its solidity, its atmosphere and its diversified surface, the rotation upon its axis, leads us on to suppose that it is most probably also inhabited, like the rest of the planets, by beings whose organs are adapted to the peculiar circumstances of that vast globe." In short, a lot of astronomers thought the Sun to be just a very big planet. Herschel even thought things were living there. It would take new technological developments in the 19th century to set astronomers on course for a deeper understanding of the Sun. 2. Unweaving the Rainbow. My heart leaps up when I behold a rainbow in the sky. So was it when my life began, so is it now I am a man. William Wordsworth. Josef von Fraunhofer was an orphan by the age of only 11. His parents died just a year apart, leaving Josef to fend for himself. He was descended from a long line of glassmakers on both sides of his family, so it was a natural step for him to take up an apprenticeship with a mirror maker. However, this meant leaving his hometown of Straubing in southern Germany and moving to Munich, some 140 kilometers away. Surely a daunting prospect for a boy not yet in his teens. Life in the Bavarian capital was not initially kind to him. His employer, Philip Anton Weichselberger was a gruff man with a fiery temper. Pay was poor, and the work was tough. Fraunhofer wanted to go to school to learn more about optics, but his request was denied. Instead, he bought himself an old textbook from a local flea market with what little money he had. His luck was about to turn in the most unlikely manner. On the 21st of July, 1801, the roof of Weichselberger's property fell in, trapping him and Fraunhofer under a pile of rubble. Both were pulled from beneath the debris after locals mounted a rescue effort lasting several hours. Prince Elector Maximilian Joseph, the heir to the Bavarian throne, visited the scene and was instantly impressed with the young glassmaker. Later, taking a keen interest in the boy's education, he gave Fraunhofer enough money to pay off Weichselberger and buy himself out of his apprenticeship. Free at last, Fraunhofer set about learning as much as he could about optics. The prince invited him to his castle and introduced him to Josef von Utzschneider, a senior Bavarian civil servant with an interest in science and technical matters. One of the first tasks the two Josefs worked on together was grinding lenses for telescopes. Not yet out of his teens, Fraunhofer was soon making the finest lenses found anywhere in Europe. At just 22, he became the director of Utzschneider's glassmaking factory, a meteoric rise from his days as an orphan in Straubing. Fraunhofer's irrepressible curiosity saw him test his exquisite lenses using sunlight, and that would soon cement his place in the history of science. By 1814, he had invented a device now known as a spectroscope, a piece of prism-like glass that can split light up into a spectrum of its constituent colors, like a raindrop does to create a rainbow. Isaac Newton pioneered similar experiments at the end of the 17th century, but Fraunhofer's skill as a glassmaker enabled him to examine the spectrum of sunlight in unprecedented detail. He quickly noticed a series of dark lines strewn throughout the otherwise vivid colors. "I saw with the telescope an almost countless number of strong and weak vertical lines, darker than the rest of the color image. Some appeared to be almost perfectly black." Within a couple of years, he published details of 574 of these lines, known today as Fraunhofer lines. Fraunhofer not only found the lines in sunlight, but also the light of other stars in the night sky, including the brightest, Sirius. Each star had a slightly different configuration of lines, giving him confidence that they were not an effect caused by the light's journey through Earth's atmosphere. The fixed composition of the air above us would always modify starlight in the same manner. The reason for the differences must lie in the stars themselves. However, he was unable to explain what was causing them. That knowledge was still a century away. In 1821, Fraunhofer manufactured a type of diffraction grating, a device often made of metal with a series of slits. These slits split light into its spectrum even more accurately than glass, and diffraction gratings have been used by astronomers ever since. He also invented the Fraunhofer heliometer, a tool that could be attached to a telescope to measure the sun's diameter. Fraunhofer's career continued to go from strength to strength, gaining a reputation as a world-class telescope maker. Maximilian Joseph, now King of Bavaria, anointed him a Knight of the Order of Civilian Service. The orphan had become a nobleman. But by 1826, Fraunhofer was dead at the age of just 39. His short but remarkable life was ended by tuberculosis. He'd been struggling with respiratory problems for some time because of his exposure to the chemicals involved in the glassblowing process. The first photograph. The same year that Fraunhofer died, Frenchman Joseph Nicéphore Niépce was pioneering a revolutionary new pastime, photography. Niepce's maiden snapshot, generally accepted to be the world's oldest photographic image, was taken of the scene outside his studio window in 1826. It's simply called View from the Window at Le Gras. Niepce also invented a technique called heliography, from the Greek words for sun and drawing. He covered a sheet of glass with a naturally occurring type of asphalt called bitumen of Judea, which hardens when exposed to sunlight. He then washed off the rest of the asphalt with lavender oil to reveal the image. The year before taking his first photograph, Niepce placed an old engraving of a man leading a horse on top of the treated glass and used his heliographic technique to transfer a replica image to it, the world's first photocopy. By 1829, he was working with fellow Frenchman Louis Daguerre, and together the pair devised new forms of photography. Niepce died of a stroke in 1833, but Daguerre continued their work and in 1839 eventually came up with the daguerreotype, the first commercially available way to take photos. It was so successful that the technology was bought by the French government, securing Daguerre 6,000 francs a year for life, and 4,000 francs annually for Niepce's family. The technology spread like wildfire around the world, and it took just 2 years for an American president to have his photo taken using the technique. A daguerreotype of William Henry Harrison was taken around the time of his inauguration in 1841. Sadly, the photo no longer exists, but it remains one of the most noteworthy things about a presidency that lasted just 32 days due to Harrison's sudden death from a mystery affliction. Just like the telescope 2 centuries earlier, it didn't take long for astronomers to turn the newest must-have gadget towards our nearest star. In 1845, the French pair of Louis Fizeau and Léon Foucault took the first ever photograph of the sun. Measuring approximately 12.5 centimeters across, the image shows the entire solar disk and even a few sunspots to boot. Foucault had started his working life as a medical doctor, a career he was forced to abandon due to a chronic fear of blood. He would later prove the Earth was rotating by swinging a giant pendulum from the roof of the Pantheon in Paris. A replica of Foucault's pendulum can still be seen there today. Both men are among an elite group of 72 scientists and engineers with their names carved into the base of the Eiffel Tower. Fizeau was the only one still alive when the monument was opened to the public in 1889. The pair's landmark photograph of the sun also showed an effect called limb darkening. The sun appears brighter in the middle and duller at the edges. This is because at the rim, we're looking through considerably less hot material than when seeing the sun face on. It was a significant hint that the heat of the sun goes a lot deeper than many astronomers had previously thought. The first photograph of a solar eclipse followed in fairly short order. Johann Berkowitz, a professional photographer rather than an astronomer, snapped it on the 28th of July, 1851, at the Royal Prussian Observatory in Königsberg, now Kaliningrad, Russia. The telescope he used had a Fraunhofer heliometer attached, and the subsequent daguerreotype image clearly shows solar prominences, along with a sighting of the corona, the sun's tenuous outermost layer. For most of human history, a solar eclipse had generally been a once-in-a-lifetime event for individual observers. It's often several centuries before the spectacle returns to the same city. Yet, the advent and ease of international travel by largely reliable sailing ships meant that the 19th century turned into an eclipse-chasing frenzy. There's an eclipse somewhere on Earth every 18 months or so, and European observatories dispatched dozens of astronomers to all corners of the world to observe the next one. One astronomer alone, Frenchman Pierre Janson, travelled to eclipses in Italy, 1867, India, 1868, Algeria, 1870, Thailand, 1875, the Caroline Islands in the Pacific, 1883, and Spain, 1905. The Algerian eclipse took place in the middle of the siege of Paris that saw the French capital locked down by Prussian troops. Janson had to be airlifted out of the besieged city by hot air balloon. Even then, he was thwarted by a cloudy day in Algiers. The solar spectrum. 4 years before that historic photograph of an eclipse was taken in Königsberg, the physicist Gustav Kirchhoff graduated from the city's university. He moved first to Berlin and then to Heidelberg, where he began collaborating with fellow German Robert Bunsen. Bunsen's name is now synonymous with a type of burner he partially invented that has a steady flame, used today in most school chemistry labs. In 1834, he had also discovered a cure for arsenic poisoning. This ultimately saved his life 9 years later, when an explosion in his laboratory during an experiment with cacodyl cyanide, an arsenic compound, blinded him in his right eye and left him with acute arsenic poisoning. He survived thanks to the cure he himself had devised. It was important for our knowledge of the sun that he did, because the work he carried out with Kirchhoff in 1859 would be a crucial step in understanding what the sun is made of. By using Bunsen's famous burner to heat pure samples of sodium, lithium, and potassium, the two scientists passed the light from the resulting flame through a spectroscope to look at its spectrum. They quickly learned that each element's spectrum is unique. Initially, these spectra were the reverse of Fraunhofer's. Rather than vivid colors broken up by dark lines, they saw darkness punctuated with bright vertical streaks. They went a step further, directing the light from a burning substance through various gases before it entered the spectroscope. In doing so, they observed dark Fraunhofer lines in the resulting spectrum. Crucially, the dark lines were in exactly the same position in that spectrum as the bright lines created when the gas itself was being burned. Each element clearly had its own unique fingerprint made up of these spectral lines. Hidden inside light, these lines are telltale clues about both the source of the light, bright lines, or what the light has passed through to reach us, dark lines. Astronomers now call these emission spectra and absorption spectra, respectively. It didn't take long for Kirchhoff to produce the first detailed map of the solar spectrum in 1861, identifying absorption, Fraunhofer lines, that matched laboratory experiments on Earth. His map contained so many spectral lines that a full printed version required 8 feet, 2.4 meters, of paper. 60 lines were linked to iron alone, many matching those only found when iron was heated in a laboratory beyond its boiling point, 2,862 degrees Celsius. Other elements he identified in the sun include barium, calcium, chromium, cobalt, copper, gold, magnesium, nickel, and zinc. It was becoming clear that the sun must be a lot hotter than previously imagined. Kirchhoff himself suggested that the visible surface of the sun was made of an incandescent liquid. Ideas like William Herschel's notion that a civilization may live on a solid surface beneath a bright top layer of clouds began to fade away. It's a picture that had continued to be popular right up until Bunsen and Kirchhoff's work. Just 5 years earlier, the French astronomer François Arago had written in his 1854 book, Astronomie Populaire, that if anyone asked me if the sun could be inhabited by a civilization like ours, I would not hesitate to say yes. Surely he wouldn't have said the same just a decade later. Such was the pace of change in solar physics in the mid-19th century, and another landmark discovery was just around the corner. New elements. 2 years before Pierre Janson escaped from besieged Paris by balloon, he'd had a far more successful trip to Guntur, India, to observe the solar eclipse of the 18th of August, 1868. Buoyed by the findings of Bunsen and Kirchhoff, Janson set about observing the eclipse with a spectroscope. He found something puzzling, a previously unseen spectral line. A bright yellow emission line, it appeared very close to two lines associated with sodium known as D1 and D2. A few months later, in October, Englishman Norman Lockyer spotted the same line and called it D3, as he too initially thought it was linked to sodium. Lockyer soon began a collaboration with English chemist Edward Frankland, who, like Fraunhofer earlier in the century, had overcome early obstacles. He was an illegitimate child, his mother having been paid a sizable sum to keep the identity of his father a secret. He later studied at the University of Marburg under Robert.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.